This week on Kirfatu.
Thank you, I'm Victor Lol Anima, delivery Dr. Ismail Obaji. Doctor, welcome to Kirfatu.
Thank you, thank you.
Your dad, a seasoned diplomat.
Yes.
Who's worked in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, ambassador, he's been a minister. But who is Dr. Ismail Obaji?
Well, I was born in Gambia. Mm-hmm. There's always two sides of the story. Yeah. Obviously, my dad has been in the public figure working as a career civil servant his whole life. But my mother, as well to my mom, Hadindong, she's the daughter of Ajafati Menga of Afdai. Mm. So our roots start from Banjo.
So we started InnovaX Global Health actually as a consulting company in Charlotte, North Carolina in 2015. Mm-hmm. And that's when we started coming back home to try to build a business model. I tell people what inspired the company most of the times is we were working, especially I was working in Charlotte, I was traveling to Gambia back and forth. My mom has diabetes. I have hypertension. So I knew that everything that I was doing very well in the US, it doesn't exist. The model does not exist in the Gambia. So why keep on working in an environment where our people need the same services? We want quality things. We deserve quality things. We have to create quality things.
Yeah.
Right? So for us to create it, we can't sit back and let somebody else do it. So that's when I started just coming home, and then we invested significantly to build a system that's actually not like the US system. Because what I tell people is, the services that we're doing now as a company, if you walk into any pharmacy in the US, you won't find these services. So that's the beauty of doing business in Africa. When you're creating something brand new, you could take everything that's good from where you are, your skills, the techniques, the technology, and then you build a model that will serve everybody in the Gambia, right? And that's what we created.
So for many entrepreneurs in the Gambia, their concern is with the scope of the market, how many people are coming to get our products and how lucrative can this be? It seems like what you're offering is innovative, but it's also new for most people. So how is the market been for you guys since you started your project?
No, I think, to be honest, everybody knows it's tough doing business in Gambia, especially if your model or all the technology that you're bringing, it's maybe 5 or 10 years ahead of where the market is, right? And it's harder even from an investment standpoint because it's a startup company. At the end of the day, I tell people we're still a startup company, right? So the Gambian market is not an investor-friendly market because the market is small. But I tell people there's money in the Gambia. Because a lot of times, if you have a service of value that people used to go out of Gambia to get it, or Gambians are spending so much money into the Gambia, almost $300 million that comes in through remittances, people need help, especially people in healthcare. So if you focus on the quality, which we did, even if it's slow for people to realize, the market will catch up and then it'll flow towards where the quality is. Yeah. So even from a competitive standpoint now, if your quality is good, even people who are in the same industry, they either have to invest more money into their technology, invest into training people on customer service, on their consistency. If not, the market is going to flow to you. That's the hope.
So I know some people will tell you stay home if you're feeling sick, you have fever, or your temperature is high. If you don't, if you don't need oxygen, you stay home. Even in America, they can take care of everybody. But once you are home, what do you do? You just stay there like that?
Yeah.
What do you do?
So we've established that so far there haven't been any treatments that's approved, like this could treat coronavirus. They're doing testing.
Yeah.
Right? They're doing testing, right? So the system is already in place. If you have symptoms, they tell you in Gambia, for example, call 1025 first and let them know I'm having symptoms. But even then, what do you do then at home? That's where supportive care comes into play. So coronavirus, the guidelines is supportive care. There's different levels of supportive care. Even getting a ventilator is still considered supportive care. So for ventilator, for people who may not understand, is once your lungs are in such a bad shape that they cannot function no more, you need a machine that's gonna act like your lungs, meaning make sure oxygen gets throughout your heart, but just to keep you alive.
Yeah.
Not everybody who has coronavirus is gonna get that critically ill.
Yeah.
So the bigger population of people who may be at home, because it's better to stay at home, you still may have a fever. So supportive care for a fever looks like taking ibuprofen or Tylenol, which are fever-reducing agents to reduce the fever. obviously having a thermometer at home where you could monitor the temperature. Because what you don't want to do too is medicate when you actually don't have a fever. So if your body temperature, let's say, is 37, that's considered, you know, you don't have a fever.
So someone like right? me, all I do right? is just...
If you do this,
right? And then I'm like, oh.
So
right?
you cannot know you have a fever by touching yourself?
It could be warm, but you want to get a tool that actually tells you, you have a high fever, right? Then you could take ibuprofen or Tylenol.
Okay.
That's equally effective, right? And then if you're coughing, what does supportive care look like? You take a cough suppressant. So dextromethorphan, something with menthol, even some of the cough drops have menthol, which is a cough suppressant. That's how you're supporting. So all of this, you're treating the symptoms over here while your immune system is fighting the virus. So you just want to support yourself as much as possible. Now, if it gets gradually worse, now you're getting to more of the under 5%, 1% area where you're getting critically ill, meaning your lungs are struggling, where you're having difficulty breathing. You may be having signs of pneumonia. That's when you need to go to a facility that could support you, right? Because even though you were infected this whole time, if you walk around and just run into every single hospital system, not only are you putting people around you at risk, you're putting the doctors at risk.
Yeah.
So if you don't have enough doctors who are healthy, then it's like a snowball effect. So you're helping suppress the demands of the health system. That's why communication is key. And people understanding that we don't have to stigmatize coronavirus. It's not like it's a death sentence or a big, you know, scar like, oh, Ismaila has coronavirus. You know, did you hear Nima has coronavirus? It's a virus that anybody could have. So people should self-volunteer to report as much as possible. We have a culture of stigma in the Gambia anyways.
Mm-hmm.
We saw the whole ordeal with the whole first patient. They made it seem like she was an alien who brought a different disease. It's counterintuitive. I remember you saying the moment you're, if I was to be infected, I'll be the loudest voice in the Gambia.
I would be the loudest voice because,
and I will stay home.
Yep.
And I tell people the virus does not care who you are.
You are,
right? So call 1025, get the right directions. And now you can leverage companies that could bring these supportive care products to you.